Hi everyone. In today's video, we're going to talk about polymorphism, one of the key components to object-oriented programming design within languages like Java. So some of the other pillars of object-oriented programming design that we've talked about previously are inheritance and encapsulation. The one we're going to talk about today is polymorphism, and then the last one, which will be a future video, is abstraction. All four of those together form a very solid set of core concepts that you need to know as a Java programmer and as somebody who's going to write good object-oriented programming. In this video, I'm going to attempt to explain polymorphism in a really straightforward way, because oftentimes, if I'm being honest, it can confuse new programmers, and the way that some people explain it is overly complicated. If you think about it, what polymorphism means, poly, so many, morphism, many morphs, many variants, kind of you could think of it in a few different ways. Basically what we're doing is we are accessing methods in a common way, but providing specific implementations of them, which you can almost think of as the opposite of inheritance, where you are accessing common methods and using them commonly. Polymorphism instead has a common access method, but then specific implementations of our methods. It's going to be a whole lot easier if I just show some examples of code, so I'll get to it already. All right, I've got some code up from one of the previous videos on inheritance. If you haven't checked out that video already, I highly recommend you do. It's difficult to understand polymorphism if you don't already have a decent understanding of inheritance, because polymorphism builds on the things that inheritance can't quite get for you. So I'll do a quick refresher on the code. We have a main class with a main method that's currently doing nothing. We have a generic athlete class, which has three public methods here. And then we have four subclasses that all inherit from athlete via this extends athlete syntax right here. And then each of these subclasses provide a public method that is only applicable for their subclass. And if you recall, when we looked at the available methods for each of these subclasses, it included those defined within the class itself, as well as those defined within the athlete. And even the athlete class also has more than just the methods mentioned here, because it implicitly also extends object. So inheritance is great, right? I can inherit common fields and methods from my parent classes into my subclasses. So for instance, let's say I make a dancer. And now I want my dancer to train. As you can see, we can use the train method. It prints out training, which is what the athlete class provides for us. That's great, but let's say I have a situation where I want to override what my parent class is doing in my subclass because I want a specific implementation for my dancer that is not applicable for my athlete. Well, inheritance won't get you that, but polymorphism will. So let's go ahead and make a train method. And now the first thing you'll notice is the IDE popped up this little thing right here. So if I hover over this, what this is saying is that this method is overriding method in athlete. So what does that mean exactly? Well, I am going to use the train method here rather than the train method in the athlete class when I make an instance of a dancer specifically. So let's say I'm gonna go ahead and print that out instead. And I'm gonna rerun the code and see what happens. And as expected, we are printing out dancing as training. So even though we're calling the train method on our dancer, which comes from athlete, we're actually calling the dancer implementation of train. And that is the fundamental concept of polymorphism. You're using a common method that means different things, different morphs in different classes. So poly, so multiple classes, multiple morphs of the same type of method here and the same invocation of our method, because we're taking the same number of arguments and everything, and it's different output. So this is really awesome, because now what we can do is we can use both inheritance and polymorphism to really customize our subclasses into the things that we want them to have while maintaining common code where we want to keep it. So let's say that I go ahead and let's change this to athlete. And you'll notice one thing I can do here called an upcast is I can create an instance of a dancer and I can assign it to an athlete. I cannot do the opposite though. If I were to assign a dancer to a new athlete, this does not work. And the reason it doesn't is because you're trying to cast a base class into a subclass. You have to do it the other way around. Just like how some rectangles are squares, but not all of them, we know that all squares are rectangles. So in our case, not all athletes are dancers, but if you're a dancer, in our case, you're an athlete. So we'll switch that back to dancer and athlete. Okay, so now if I call athlete.train, I get the same output because my athlete is specifically a dancer. But now let's change it to a baseball player. Now what happens? All right, now we're back to using the athlete implementation of the train method, because if we go to our baseball player, we can see that we have not overridden our athlete implementation of train. Again, polymorphism is a very powerful feature of object-oriented programming, because what it allows you to do is have very common code used later on in your methods and in your software, but then the actual class whose implementation you're using can be abstracted away when you then go and instantiate it. This gets a little bit into the details of abstraction, and I won't go too far into that because that's a separate topic. But the fundamental thing we're showing here is that with polymorphism, you can now create multiple different behaviors with what looks like similar objects, because our base class provides all of these common methods, and our subclasses can provide specific implementations of the common methods where necessary, but they're not forced on us in this case. So I want to go through an example that's a common programming mistake that you might see. Let's go ahead and change this over to a baseball player. So the code would currently act the same. But now let's say I want to add an argument into the train method. Now I'm going to make a train method that takes an argument, just integer I. So now we're going to train for a certain number of days. That's what our I variable is. In fact, let's actually go ahead and rename this. Number of days. So what we're doing here is we made a train method with an argument for the number of days that we're going to train for, and then we're printing this out here. So if I go ahead and compile this, we can see this is the output we get. Technically, this is also polymorphism, because now if I do athlete.train, I now have the train method of the athlete class, and I have this train method of the baseball player class, and they're different because they take different arguments. And this is actually another form of polymorphism where we're doing what's called method overloading. So it's really important to distinguish between method overwriting and method overloading. So the first thing we did when we showed the example in the dancer class right here, this is what's called a method override, because we are overriding the implementation of our athlete class here, and the IDE even tells us this right here. Whereas if we look at the baseball player here, we're not doing anything special with overriding. This is called method overloading and doesn't even require inheritance. It's really easy sometimes to accidentally overload when you meant to override, or vice versa. So one way to make sure that you are correctly overriding rather than overloading is you can use the override annotation. So what this does is it makes it explicit, hey, this is intended to be an override, and if it's not, you'd better tell me. So if I try to say that the train method here, which is a method overload, is now an override, you can see that I've got an error here, and even if I spell it correctly. Okay, so now if I hover over this, method does not override method from its superclass. And now you can see a lot of information on what an override annotation does. The override annotation is a very useful annotation you should use in your code. It's not strictly necessary to compile your code, but kind of like comments, it's one of those things that are very useful for future programmers, and it's a future-proofing mechanism to verify that when your base class changes, now you need to make sure that you update your subclasses so that you are correctly continuing to override rather than overload your methods. Note that there's nothing wrong with method overloading. In fact, oftentimes that's the correct answer, and you don't even need to worry about inheritance and polymorphism via overwriting methods, but you need to be explicit with defining whether you're going to do an override or an overload. All right, so I'm going to go ahead and get rid of this. And now one thing I want to demonstrate is a couple things that you can see within the IDE that indicate that you are doing what you want to do. Again, these are nice indications that the IDE gives you. You can see all of our subclass types, that subclass, our athlete class. And then here, you can see that our train method is overridden by the dancer class, but not our other subclasses. So again, this is just another thing that IntelliJ as an IDE provides for you. Take full advantage of your tools and use them to your fullest because they are often your friend and want to help you. And in fact, I'm going to have IntelliJ help me here as well. I'm going to go ahead and tell that I want to start an override. I just start typing the override annotation, and it asks me, which method do you want to override? And in this case, what I want to show is I want to override the toString method within the object class. And what this did here is it created a default implementation, and it uses what's called the super keyword. I'll go ahead and talk about that in a video coming up. Basically, at a high level, this isn't actually doing any real overriding because I'm just calling the base class's implementation. So I'm gonna go ahead and get rid of this. And now I want to create an implementation for athlete that's different from the object to string method's default. Let's go ahead and keep this super simple, and we'll just say this is an athlete. And then in our baseball player, let's go ahead and also override toString. This is a baseball player. So now if we go and print out our athlete, we should call the toString method of baseball player. And there you have it. Now we print out that this is a baseball player. Now let's go ahead, just demonstrate one more time that this works as expected. We could make this an athlete, or we could even make this an object. Let's make this an athlete this time. All right, now we are using the athlete implementation of the toString method within the object class. And now this time, let's go ahead and rename the variable just so that I'm not misleading us. One way to refactor quickly is you can do Shift F6 on Windows. Now I'm going to go ahead and change this to object. And it changes all instances of my name automatically for me. Again, that's a really slick way to quickly refactor code. This time, let's go ahead and let's use a class we've used before. Let's use a scanner. And we did import scanner there. We'll do it over system.in. And this time, oh wait, we can't close it. That's right, because we did an upcast into our object. So we'll let the garbage collector do the closing for us. Okay. So now what's the toString method of scanner look like? And would you look at that? I'm gonna turn my video off for a second so we can see this. So as we can see, the default toString implementation of the scanner class is quite different from the toString implementation of the object class. Just to remind everyone of what object looks like, I'll go ahead and run this quickly. And as that reminder, it is the name of the class, at symbol, and then a hexadecimal version of the hash code. So within the Java language, some of our utility classes that the language provides for us also override these common methods of object, and they use polymorphism as well. So as you can see, inheritance and polymorphism are very tied together, but they're two very distinct things and accomplish different goals. And there you have it. Those are the fundamentals of how we do polymorphism within Java. Personally, in code that I write, I use polymorphism and inheritance all the time because it's really useful to not have to repeat your own code, but then also be able to differentiate specific implementations within subclasses where you have more intimate knowledge of what your object needs to do. Those two things together are really powerful features of object-oriented programming, and I really like using them in my own code. If you like this video and want to keep seeing this sort of content, please do hit that like button. I'd really appreciate it. Thank you for taking the time to watch this video. I hope to see you next time, and I hope you have a good rest of your day. Thanks, and take care.